Full Moon by Jim Butcher. Print publication by ROC, a division of Penguin Putnam. This production is brought to you by Buzzy Multimedia Audiobooks and is read to you by James Marsters.
Chapter 1. I never used to keep close track of the phases of the moon, so I didn't know that it was one night shy of being full when a young woman sat down across from me in McAnally's pub and asked me to tell her all about something that could get her killed. No, I said, absolutely not. I folded the piece of paper with its drawing of three concentric rings of spidery symbols and slid it back over the polished oak wood table. Kim Delaney frowned at me and brushed some of her dark, shining curtain of hair back from her forehead. She was a tall woman, buxom and lovely in an old-world way, with pale, pretty skin and round cheeks well used to smiling. She wasn't smiling now. Oh, come on, Harry, she told me. You're Chicago's only practicing professional wizard, and you're the only one who can help me. She leaned across the table towards me, her eyes intent. I can't find the references for all these symbols. No one in local circles recognizes them either. You're the only real wizard I've ever heard of, much less know. I just want to know what these others are. No, I told her. You don't want to know. You're better off forgetting this circle and concentrating on something else. But Mac caught my attention from behind the bar by waving a hand at me and slid a couple of plates of steaming food onto the polished surface of the crooked oak bar. He added a couple of bottles of his homemade brown ale, and my mouth started watering. My stomach made an unhappy noise. It was almost as empty as my wallet. I would never have been able to afford dinner tonight, except that Kim had offered to buy if I talked to her about something during the meal. A steak dinner was less than my usual rate, but she was pleasant company and a sometime apprentice of mine. I knew she didn't have much money, and I had even less. Despite my rumbling stomach, I didn't rise immediately to pick up the food. In McAnally's pub and grill, there aren't any service people. According to Mac, if you can't get up and walk over to pick up your own order, you don't need to be in there at all. I looked around the room for a moment, with its annoying combination of low ceilings and lazily spinning fans, its 13 carved wood columns and 13 windows, plus 13 tables, arranged haphazardly to defray and scatter the residual magical effects that sometimes surround hungry, in other words, angry, wizards. McAnally's was a haven in a town where no one believed in magic. A lot of the crowd ate there. Look, Harry, Kim said, I'm not using this for anything serious, I promise. I'm not trying any summoning or binding. It's an academic interest only, something that's been bothering me for a while. She leaned forward and put her hand over mine, looking me in the face without looking me in the eyes, a trick that few non-practitioners of the art could master. She grinned and showed me the deep dimples in her cheeks. My stomach growled again. I glanced over at the food on the bar, waiting for me. You sure? I asked her. This is just you trying to scratch an itch? You're not using it for anything? Cross my heart, she said, doing so. I frowned. I don't know. She laughed at me. Oh, come on, Harry. It's no big deal. Look, if you don't want to tell me, never mind. I'll buy you dinner anyway. I know you're tight for money lately, since that thing last spring, I mean. I glowered, but not at Kim. It wasn't her fault that my main employer, Karen Murphy, the director of special investigations at the Chicago PD, hadn't called me for consulting work in more than a month. Most of my living for the past few years had come from serving as special consultant to SI, but after a fracas last spring involving a dark wizard fighting a gang war for control of Chicago's drug trade, work with SI had slowly tapered off, and with it, my income. I don't know why Murphy hadn't called me in as often. I had my suspicions, but I hadn't got the chance to confront her about them yet. Maybe it wasn't anything I'd done. Maybe the monsters had gone on strike. Yeah, right. The bottom line was I was strapped for cash. I'd been eating ramen noodles and soup for too many weeks. The steaks Mac had prepared smelled like heaven, even across the room. My belly protested again, growling its Neolithic craving for charred meat. But I couldn't just go and eat the dinner without giving Kim the information she wanted. It's not that I never welched on a deal, but I'd never done it with anyone human, and definitely not with someone who looked up to me. Sometimes I hate having a conscience, and a stupidly thorough sense of honor. All right, I sighed. Let me get the dinner, and I'll tell you what I know. Kim's round cheeks dimpled again. Thanks, Harry. This means a lot to me. Yeah, I told her, and got up to weave my way toward the bar, through the columns and tables and so on. McAnally's had more people than usual tonight, and though Mac rarely smiled, there was a contentment to his manner that indicated he was happy with the crowd. I snatched up the plates and bottles with a somewhat petulant attitude. It's hard to take much joy in a friend's prosperity when your own business is about to go under. I took the food, steaks and potatoes and green beans, back to the table and sat down again, placing Kim's plate in front of her. We ate for a while, myself in sullen silence and she in a hearty hunger. So, Kim said finally, what can you tell me about that? She gestured toward the piece of paper with her fork. I swallowed my food, took a sip of the rich ale, and picked up the paper again. All right. This is a figure of high magic. Three of them, really, one inside the other, like layered walls. Remember what I told you about magic circles? Kim nodded. They either hold something out or keep something in. Most work on magic energies, or creatures of the never-never, but mortal creatures can cross the circle and break them. Right, I said. That's what this outermost circle of symbols is. It's a barrier against creatures of spirit and magical forces. These symbols here, here, here are the key ones. I pointed out the squiggles in question. Kim nodded eagerly. I got the outer one. What's the next? The second circle is more of a spell barrier to mortal flesh. It wouldn't work if all you used was a ring of symbols. You'll need something else, stones or gems or something, space between the drawings. I took another bite of steak. Kim frowned at the paper and then at me. And then what would that do? Invisible wall, I told her, like bricks. Spirits, magic, could go right through it, but mortal flesh couldn't. Neither could a thrown brick, bullets, anything purely physical. I see, she said, excited. Sort of a force field. I nodded, something like that. Her cheeks glowed with excitement and her eyes shone. I knew it. And what's this last one? I squinted at the innermost ring of symbols, frowning. A mistake. What do you mean? I mean that it's gobbledygook. It doesn't mean anything useful. Are you sure you copied this correctly? Kim's mouth twisted into a frown. I'm sure. I was careful. I studied her face for a moment. If I read the symbols correctly, it's a third wall, built to withhold creatures of flesh and spirit. Neither mortal nor spirit, but somewhere in between. She frowned. What kind of creatures are like that? I shrugged. None, I said, and officially it was true. The White Council of Wizards did not allow the discussion of demons that could be called to Earth, beings of spirit that could gather flesh to themselves. Usually a spirit circle was enough to stop all but the most powerful demons or elder things of the outer reaches of the never-never. But this third circle was built to stop things that could transcend those kinds of boundaries. It was a cage for demonic demigods and archangels. Kim wasn't buying my answer. I don't see why anyone would make a circle like this to contain nothing, Harry. I shrugged. People don't always do reasonable, sensible things. They're like that. She rolled her eyes at me. Come on, Harry. I'm not a baby. You don't have to shelter me. And you, I told her, don't need to know what kind of thing this third circle was built to contain. You don't want to know, trust me. She glowered at me for a long moment, then sipped at her ale and shrugged. All right. Circles have to be empowered, right? You have to know how to switch them on, like lights. Something like that, sure. How could a person turn this one on? I stared at her for a long time. Harry, she asked, you don't need to know that either. Not for an academic interest. I don't know what you've got on your mind, Kim, but leave it alone. Forget it. Walk away before you get hurt. Harry, I'm not... Save it, I told her. You're sitting on a tiger cage, Kim. I thumbed a finger on the paper for emphasis. And you wouldn't need it if you weren't planning on trying to stick a tiger in there. Her eyes glittered, and she lifted her chin. You don't think I'm strong enough. Your strength's got nothing to do with it, I said. You don't have the training. You don't have the knowledge. I wouldn't expect a kid in grade school to be able to sit down and figure out college calculus, and I don't expect it of you either. I leaned forward. You don't know enough yet to be toying with this sort of thing, Kim. And even if you did manage to become a full-fledged wizard, I'd still tell you not to do it. You messed this up, and you could get a lot of people hurt. If I was planning to do that, it's my business, Harry. Her eyes were bright with anger. You don't have the right to choose for me.